idea that it's all up to me and I have to do it is exactly going in the opposite direction from non-duality, which is to say everything is unseparated, everything is already linked. So don't withdraw into isolation, but find yourself as part of the participative field. So when we do the Guru Yoga, and we're imagining this, the presence of the teachers in front of us, it's not that we need their blessing, it's that we and they have the same nature, and by this opening, we find the mutuality that we have in our ground, in our clarity, and in our moment-by-moment unfolding. So when we listen, the idea is not to accumulate a lot of technical knowledge, which of course can be helpful. The key thing is to allow the sound to be a kind of massage that softens the need to hold ourselves together so that we can find ourselves more relaxed and more open. Because we have this modern possibilities, what I'm saying here is being videoed, and you have sound recordings, and there are many books, you can look at these later, but books you can always have with you. Our meeting together is very rare. We don't know if we ever meet together again. You know, there are many teachers who suddenly vanish. It's like that, we never know. A car crash, plane can fall out of the sky, anything can happen. So we never know. So we have a chance to generate together a field of participation in which we are collaborating in friendly openness. Now, that's not something I find in the streets of London. Maybe you're luckier where you live. But for me, the experience of modern cities is fairly desolate, as people are absolutely wrapped in their self-concern. So we have a very rare and precious opportunity to experience the feeling tone of collaboration, to allow ourselves to be less defended, less isolated, and find these pulsations of connectivity. So we meet people's eyes, you chat together a little bit, and we're belonging, but we're not belonging in a sect or a group, there's no membership card, we're belonging in the open field of clarity that we all emerge from moment by moment. Well, that's just how one might listen. And of course, with that background in the West, we start usually from the point of view of the individual. And we talk of lamas as reincarnations, back in the meat again. Because that's what it is, back in the carne. This is a completely perverse translation. The Tibetan is a trupeku. Ku means mode or body, but more like a kind of modality of expression. And trupa means magical, means illusory, means in English, probably the best translation would be apparition. It's something that's almost like a ghost or a specter, something you see, but it's not quite there. Again, it's like a rainbow. So it's not that we come from openness into big, heavy, clunking solidity. This solidity is generated out of our own attachment, our own investment. We make the world opaque, solid, heavy, and then we see other people as separate from us and full of themselves. We see people in terms of their personality. But of course, their personality is a potential that unfolds in different situations. You can never know who a person is. You only have little glimpses of how they are. We are sculptural. We are three-dimensional or multi-dimensional. As you walk around a big sculpture, you get this impression, then this impression, then this impression. You can never capture a sculpture all at once. You can never capture a person. The whole idea of capturing it is to be in delusion. So we are all this apparitional showing, or the manifesting, but the manifesting of appearance and emptiness. this potential is then filled or enters into a dance or co-emerges with the particularities of what we project into it, or we find it being evoked in ourselves around this form moment by moment. So you might have some sense of friendliness with a person here, you might have some kind of erotic connection, you might have some kind of aversive feeling. These are the pulsations that open up aspects and close down. So we are in a pulsatory field, and this is what the Nirmanakaya, the Trupe Ku, is showing, that you can't define a person, and it is the non-definition which is actually the force of liberation. Now, clearly the social culture of Tibet didn't support this understanding very well, because you have the throne, and on the throne you have the Rinpoche, and the Rinpoche is very good, and you read the biography and you know something about the Rinpoche. And you read, oh, he was born in this village in Tibet, and his uncle was this man. So now we know, hey, this is a man. And this man had a mom and a dad and whatever. And that is a way to become stupid. The stupefaction of social identity. And it's so merged into the dynamics of patriarchy in Tibet, of power, of hierarchy, of thrones, and this and that, in which knowledge precedes the appearance. You know about the Lama before they arrive, but knowing about is by definition the meal ticket, the currency of samsara. So I invite the Lama into my samsara, and then we have holy samsara. But this is devious and unhelpful, and you find it in Hinduism as well, famous yogis and so on. Who is in front of us? Look, listen, and learn. This is what we say to three-year-old children. It's very helpful advice. Look, listen, and learn. The learning comes after the looking and listening. But we are the adults. We know, don't look very much, and assume. This is not much progress. Better to stay as a three-year-old. What is here? How can I see what is here when I keep telling what is here what it is? So this is how we watch our own mind. I never have fresh experience because I make the world stale. I tell the world what it is. The freshness of each moment shows itself, but through my apprehension, through my holding it and putting it into the little templates that I have of interpretation, I mix the fresh and the stale, the new and the old. So the apparitional form of the Trupe Ku is beyond grasping, and everyone is beyond grasping. So if we don't grasp at ourselves, we start to have more liberation. Self-knowledge is a terrible thing. To know yourself. To know yourself is to turn yourself into a thing, a knowable entity, a commodity. We don't know who we are. Why would we have to know who we are? Because we become according to circumstances. When the Buddha emanates or shows this form in the world, he does it for the other.